Hello everyone, I, Professor Tilottama Barhate, welcome you for the session for Modular Arithmetic and Theory of Congruences. We normally use Modular Arithmetic in our day-to-day life. Here I am going to explain you it in using simple two examples which we use regularly. Clock and the calendar. We see it every day, isn't it? Consider one scenario where you have to catch the train which is scheduled at 9 p.m. but now it is delayed by 16 hours. So now at what time you expect the train to reach the station? Well, look at the clock. 9 a.m. added 16 hours to it, we get 1 p.m. How? Let's split 16 hours in two parts, 12 plus 4. Why 12? Because we can see only 12 hours on the clock dial. So let us add 12 hours to 9 p.m. We get 9 a.m. To this 9 a.m., we can add the remaining 4 hours so that we can get 1 p.m. So now we have understood that our train will be reaching the station 1 p.m. the next day. Similarly, suppose if I announce a maths test for you all. That will be held after 12 days from the second Monday. I would like to know, is it a weekday? How I'll find it? I'll simply grab a calendar and look at my second Monday, which is 13th of April. I'll add 7 days to it because I can have 7 days in a week. So once I add 7 days, I'll get the next Monday, that is 20th. And if I add 5 more days to it, I'll be getting 25, which gives me a Saturday. That means if I decide to keep my maths test after 12 days, I cannot keep it because it is not a weekday. So what exactly we did? In case of time, we divided the number by 12 and added the remainder to the earlier time. Why? Because we can see only 12 hours on a clock dial. Similarly, in case of days calculation, we divided by 7 and add the remainder to the earlier day because we have only 7 days per week. Same thing can be used in case of months, and we divide it by 12 if we are finding the months after a few months. This gives rise to a concept of finding a remainder obtained when A is divided by N. This is denoted by A mod N. One more relation I want to define here is congruence relation. From Euclidean algorithm, we already know A is equal to NQ plus R. If I have this relation between A and N, I can write or I can say A is congruent to R modulo N, written as A is congruent to R modulo N. That means when I divide A by N, I'm going to get remainder R. Same thing I can rewrite in terms of congruence relation like this. For example, 12 modulo 5, that is, if I need to find remainder when my 12 is divided by 5, I know it is true. Same thing can be said in terms of congruence relation as 12 is congruent to 2 modulo 5. Now, if the number is divisible, that is 12 modulo 2 is 0, then I can write 12 is congruent to 0 modulo 2. This way, for time, we have used modulo 12 and for days, we have used modulo 7. Now, I want to bring you to the concept of congruency class. Let us take some value for n, let it be 3. Observe few things, that if I consider 29 modulo 3, it gives me 2 as the remainder. 17 is also giving me remainder 2 and 38 is also giving me remainder 2. So all such integers which are leaving remainder 2 when divided by 3 are referred as the notation 2 into square bracket suffix with 3. The suffix denotes modulo 3. Set of all such integers is called as congruency class. So if I write the set of all such integers which leave remainder 2, I can call it as congruency class of 2 modulo 3. Mathematically denoted by R modulo n, set of all integers leaving remainder R when divided by n, called congruency class of R modulo n. Example, for 4, congruency class of 4 modulo 5, I can have the integers minus 6, minus 1, which leaves negative remainder for me, and 4, 9, 14, which leaves positive remainder for me after divided by 5. This is called as congruency class of 4 modulo 5. Properties of congruence relation. If I have the relation A is congruent to R modulo n, I can say n divides A minus R, or in other words, I can say A minus R by n should be an integer always. It cannot be a fraction. A is always congruent to itself. If A is congruent to B modulo n, then I can have B is also congruent to A modulo n. Transitivity, A and B follow congruence relation. Similarly, B and C follows the congruence relation. Then A and C will also follow the congruency relation. That means A is congruent to C modulo n. Now, these are some special properties. A is congruent to B mod n will imply that if I add a number k to both sides, my congruency relation will be still satisfied. Same thing goes with multiplication. AK will be congruent to BK mod n, and same thing will go with the power of both the numbers. A raised to K is congruent to B raised to K modulo n, and this gives rise to any function of A is congruent to any function of B modulo n. This is another property. This is one of the important theorem we have in number theory, Fermat's little theorem. It says if P is a prime and does not divide A, then A raised to P minus 1 can be written as congruent to 1 modulo P. And this relation holds for any A and any prime P. We will discuss in detail about the Fermat's little theorem in our next session. So right now we are going to concentrate on congruency relation and its properties. Let me take you to a few examples so that you can understand how we are going to use these properties. Solved examples. My question is, obtain a remainder when 23 raised to 15 is divided by 7. We can write 23 as 7 into 3 plus 2. That is, 23 is congruent to 2 modulo 7. 23 raised to 15 is congruent to 2 raised to 15 modulo 7 using the property A raised to K is congruent to B raised to K modulo n. Now if we observe, this remainder 2 raised to 15 is definitely greater than 7, but normally we would like to have a remainder which should be smaller than n, so it should be smaller than 7. So we will work with this 2 raised to 15. Calculating this 2 raised to 15 will be difficult. So we will take the smallest steps to solve this. I can easily observe that 2 raised to 3, that is 8, is 1 modulo 7. So we raise 23 to 3. 23 raised to 3 is congruent to 8 modulo 7, which is indeed congruent to 1 modulo 7. Now I can just bring the power to 15. So 23 raised to 3 raised to 5 gives me 23 raised to 15. Will be congruent to 1 mod 7. As a result, my remainder is 1 in this case. This way, even without calculating the bigger number, I can find the divisibility of those numbers by certain another integers. Second example, obtain 19 raised to 341 mod 5 means I need to find a remainder when my 19 raised to 341 is divided by 5. Again, we can go back to Euclid's algorithm. 19 is 5 into 3 plus 4. That means my remainder is 4 actually. But if I get my remainder to be 1, it is easy for me to raise to it to any power. So I'm interested to get 1 somewhere. This same relation can be written using negative remainder as 19 is equal to 5 into 4 minus 1. So my minus 1 becomes the remainder now. So 19 is congruent to minus 1 for mod 5. Just done for the simplification. I can easily say 19 square is congruent to 1 mod 5. We did this because it is always easier to work with 1 mod 5. Now 341 can be written as this. So 19 raised to 341 can be written as 19 raised to some bigger number into 19. Let's consider that bigger number 19 raised to 2 raised to 170 is congruent to 1 mod 5 because I have raised the earlier expression to power 170. 1 raised to 170 will be 1 itself. Let us multiply 19 on both sides. I'm going to get 19 raised to 341 is congruent to 19 modulo 5. 19 is greater than 5, so we will reduce that. This 19 mod 5 gives me 4. Which is 4 modulo 5. So I can say 19 raised to 341 is congruent to 4 modulo 5 and thus my remainder is 4. Another type of question you can have here. The next question is obtain units digit for 7 raised to 2341. You can see it's a bigger number. Now I can see 7 raised to 1 is 7, 7 raised to 2 is 49, 7 raised to 3 is 343, and 7 raised to 4 is 2401. The units digits for any power of 7 can be any one of those only, 7 or 9 or 3 or 1. How am I going to get a units digit of a certain number? I can obtain it when I divide the number by 10. My remainder will be the units digit. So we will work with modulo 10 here. The easiest thing for me would be using 2401 as it leaves remainder 1 when I divide it by 10. So 7 raised to 4 is congruent to 1 modulo 10. Now let us define a relation between this 4 and 2341, which is given by 585 into 4 plus 1. As a result, my 7 raised to 2341 will be written as 7 raised to some bigger number into 7. 7 raised to that bigger number will be congruent to 1 modulo 10. Multiplying the both sides with 7, I get it is 7 modulo 10 and the remainder 7, which is less than 10. So I can say my 7 raised to 2341 is congruent to 7 modulo 10. Thus, my remainder is 7. And I can say units digit is 7. Show that 13 divides 9 raised to 236 minus 3. What we need to do? We need to show that 13 divides 2 raised to 9 raised to 236 minus 3. That means I need to show that 9 raised to 236 minus 3 is some multiple of 13. In other words, I can say I need to show that 2 raised to 236 is congruent to 3 modulo 13. For this, again, we will look at powers of 9. And I can see 9 raised to 3 gives me congruency relation with 1 modulo 3. So I'm going to use this 3. And relation of 3 with 236 can be written like this. 9 raised to 236 can be written as 9 raised to 3 raised to 78 into 9 square. Indeed, I can say 9 raised to 3 raised to 78 is congruent to 1 modulo 13 using the property again. So 9 raised to 236 will be congruent to 81 modulo 13. Now this 81 modulo 13 will give me answer equal to 3. So I can say 9 raised to 236 is congruent to 3 modulo 13. And thus I have proven that 13 divides 9 raised to 236 minus 3. Now in case of this minus 3, if I am having some plus 3 or plus 5, something like that, I have to go with the negative remainder. So I need to find the negative remainder for this. These are some of the exercises which you can try, and you can try to understand the concepts which I have discussed here. These are the varieties of the questions you can have. Thank you.